I'm Jim Lardner, and this is Feet to the Fire, a hopeful shout out to the Biden administration, the Democratic Party, and the world of progressive activists. In this weekly podcast, I'll be talking to thoughtful and caring citizens, insiders, outsiders, academics, organizers, warriors for racial and gender equity, and economic and environmental justice about the big questions facing our new leaders of government and how the rest of us can help them rise to the occasion.
This land was made for you and me.
On July 9th, the Biden administration issued an executive order that was intended to promote competition and, as the president said, to lower prices, increase wages, and take another critical step toward an economy that works for everybody. No more tolerance, he said, for abusive actions by monopolies, no more bad mergers that lead to mass layoffs, higher prices, fewer options for workers and consumers alike. My guest today is Morgan Harper, Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Economic Liberties Project, an organization founded just last October with the aim of translating, in its words, the intellectual victories of the anti-monopoly movement into concrete, wide-ranging policy changes that begin to address today's crisis of concentrated economic power. Morgan Harper, welcome to the podcast. There's a lot to this executive order, but perhaps you can illustrate its scope and ambition by just talking about a few of the concerns it addresses and a few of the initiatives it proposes.
Yeah, for sure. And thanks so much for having me, Jim. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk more about this really historic executive order. The first main point is that this executive order makes a very clear statement about the failure of a generation of economic policy thinking that has prioritized efficiency over all else, thinking that as long as consumer prices are staying low, then everything is okay, and really defining that we have a concentration problem. That problem is leading to all sorts of harms, like decreased wages for the average American household, less purchasing power, and we need to do something about it. And so the fact that the executive order talks about big tech, which has been the market area and industry that has gotten the most attention probably in the competition policy, anti-monopoly space over the last few years, but also gets into a lot of different sectors from pharmaceutical prices to the price of hearing aids to agricultural contracts and farmers and right to repair for their equipment, really just demonstrates how big the consolidation crisis is. The executive order also provides a roadmap, and it instructs the federal bureaucracy to get to work. And it's not just the Federal Trade Commission and the Department of Justice, which are the usual agencies that people think of to deal with these issues, but also it's the Department of Agriculture, it's the FDA, it's the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau that have a role to play in advancing an anti-monopoly and pro-competition policy agenda. And one of the most important or impactful statements that the president made in his remarks that accompanied the release of the executive order was that saying this, allowing this system to continue, is really exploitation. We're kidding ourselves if we think that four companies controlling an entire market and then multiplying that across the economy is really leading to good outcomes for workers, for businesses, or really for us as a country, because there also are democratic implications to all of this as well.
You live in Columbus, Ohio. You grew up in Columbus. You ran for Congress there in a Democratic Party primary last year. Where and how do you see the impact of corporate consolidation in your hometown?
Well, once you start focusing on these issues, you really, it's hard to avoid actually recognizing the impact of corporate consolidation. Let's take food supply. If you look at a lot of neighborhoods in Columbus, there's a lot of economic segregation. Actually, Columbus is one of the most economically segregated places in the country. One of the effects of that is that you will have neighborhoods that are food deserts, and you might only have one grocery store or one carryout. You don't really have any choice. It's actually almost a this like illusion of choice. And that leads to one company that actually is owning all of the food choices that then can charge as much as they want for some of those products. Then also those larger corporation and corporate run grocery stores are able to pay their workers less because there's nowhere else to work. That's a dynamic that's impacting both us as consumers and also people as workers, and an industry that has become highly consolidated over the past generation, over my lifetime, let's call it, you know, almost 40 years. We see that in Columbus, and it's happening all over the country.
What's happened to the small business scene overall in Columbus? Are there as many independent, locally owned businesses as you remember from your childhood?
No, not at all. And in fact, I grew up at one of these intersections where it's sort of like the centerpiece of the economic segregation. There used to be multiple grocery stores in just within walking distance of where I grew up. And almost all of them have closed or consolidated just be one. And it's just a big one. And the quality of the produce is not as good at all. I have seen how much the neighborhood has changed over time, how you would have the neighborhood grocery store. You would know the people who were working there. You would have the person behind the deli counter that also would be a familiar face. So yeah, I mean, it's across all sectors. So you take that to hardware stores. I think a lot of us have a memory of having more independent pharmacists. Right now, as an independent pharmacist, aren't able to compete when you have the CVSs of the world that are really dominating the market. It's kind of everywhere. And it's sad because sometimes these issues can be thought of as niche economic issues, but it's not just that. We've lost the very fabric of what makes our community strong.
The internet started out as a kind of godsend for small businesses, but it seems to have morphed into a hellscape for them.
Well, I think we've allowed it to morph into something else. You know, if there's one takeaway from all of this too, it's that none of this is inherent. It's all subject to what we decide we want the rules of the game to be. And part of the problem here is with the internet and with a lot of these other markets, we have deferred to dominant players' views on what's the best outcome for society. But that really isn't their role. It's the role of us as people and as, again, you know, the elected officials that we choose to decide what the best rules of the road are for our economy and for our country. And so, you know, the internet obviously has been a big and impactful tool for all sorts of entrepreneurs. But at this point, there's so much dominance among the big tech platforms there. We haven't seen the same boom in innovation. Actually, you know, in the economy wide, we're seeing a decrease in innovation over this generation. And that's another impact of this concentration crisis. So, you know, again, good sign to have Joe Biden moving in this direction because, yeah, it's another one of the things that we're told. It's like, oh, well, if you just let the free market go, you know, then we have small businesses, entrepreneurs, everyone can start, you know, this dream company in their garage. And it's just not the case. Innovation has flatlined and we need to be real about what's going on here. It's very difficult to compete even as a medium-sized business, let alone a smaller business. And that's what this executive order is getting at. And, you know, and another example from the executive order, you know, take something like right to repair. The fact that you have big companies that are forcing both farmers and then, you know, consumers that own tech products to go back to them or have a contract where you have to go to them to get anything fixed rather than opening up the market and having independent small businesses perhaps that could then also repair equipment. That would be, to me, you know, and to I think a lot of people, not only more logical and fair, but also in some ways more efficient, right? That you don't have to, you know, wait in line or just have one option, that you actually could go down the street and have someone who could provide you with a service. This isn't fantasy land. This is something that we used to have more of and we have just conceded power.
I'm talking to Morgan Harper, Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Economic Liberties Project. A number of these tasks, the ones laid out in the executive order, will fall at least in part to the Federal Trade Commission. Listeners may be forgiven for not knowing a lot about this agency because it hasn't done a lot in recent years, at least not when measured against what it was originally meant to do and has sometimes done in the past. You worked at the FTC for a while. Can you talk a little bit about it in theory and practice and in the light of your own experience there?
Yeah, so the FTC has tremendous power. It was founded to really address a lot of these issues that we're talking about, not only directly through the use of its authority as an agency itself, but also as a resource for other parts of the federal government to address competition issues. And for me personally, working at the FTC was my first job after college, because I had this sense that, having focused on a lot of social issues as a younger person, that really what was at the core of those issues was people just not having enough money. And that if we were using the government to somehow address the economy, then we could help improve people's lives. And so having an agency that was combining both the focus on social issues, but also strong economic policy, seemed like a good fit. Unfortunately, I got to the FTC fresh out of college, ready to get to work and really move with urgency to help people, and encountered the reputation of the federal bureaucracy, that it's slow, that people aren't really connected to that, what's being lost on the ground that we were just talking about and I was describing. And I ended up quitting. I was like, look, this is a waste of time. I don't feel like this is really a mission-driven organization that understands we're in the fight of our lives here, and I'm out. And so, in some ways, I understand the skepticism that people have. And I've even heard it expressed about this executive order by people who are on the side of really studying these issues and advocating for them of, well, what does this really mean? What can we really accomplish? And look, I mean, we have a lot of work to undo over a generation of lax antitrust enforcement, of letting concentration get out of control, of allowing large corporations to run the economy and our government. It will take time for the FTC, even under the leadership of someone who clearly understands these issues, like the new chair, Lena Khan, to start to have an impact. But we know for sure what will happen with the alternative, right? If we continue on the path that we've been on, it's a path that is leading to the demise, again, of the very fabric of our country. And these are the types of steps that need to be taken to start to have the FTC really use its authority to do something. And we're already seeing that. I mean, the fact that they're going to do an in-depth investigation of Amazon's proposed merger with MGM, the fact that they're holding the first public hearings, allowing for public comment in decades at the agency. These are the signs of what it will take for the agency to really live up to its founding mission. And it's great to see that in the executive order, they're recognizing FTC's authority in that way and are encouraging it. It's an independent agency, so they can't tell them directly what to do, but encouraging the commission to really get to work. And it's long overdue.
Joe Biden's career up to now has not been the obvious background for an antitrust crusader. How did this come about, do you think, and how seriously do you regard it?
I regard it pretty seriously. I mean, I think because the breadth of the executive order, that it really is attacking so many different market areas, that it's being honest about the impacts, that it's challenging this ideology that has dominated political thought on both sides of the aisle, to be honest, over the past 40 years at least. That is a real shift in thinking. And, even though, yes, no guarantees coming out of an executive order, but the fact that the president was willing to use his bully pulpit in this way and the executive order power to set this as a priority is pretty important. How he got to that point, look no further than his remarks. If we can believe what he says, and I hope that we can, it's because he's looking around and seeing the impacts of what's happened, seeing that workers have lost their ability to compete in the marketplace, that all the lies that were being fed by some of these large corporations about why these anti-competitive tactics are necessary, like a non-compete clause for a retail worker, right? To say that they can't go and work for another competing company, even without ever having access to things like trade secrets or whatever. This is not the American way of life that we profess to believe in. This is not how an economy actually ensures that if you put the work in, you're going to be okay. We cannot continue to accept this ideology that if a large corporation is saying it's so, then we just all defer and keep it moving. And in fact, know that we have the power as people who elect representatives who then have the authority to use the government to 100% do something about it. And we should. So it really is a crisis. I mean, the fact that people are working so hard and don't have any job security, that the wages aren't keeping up with the cost of living. And there's a lot of different constituencies ringing the alarm here. This is not just like a clearly left, quote unquote, right, quote unquote issue, that you have farmers, that you have independent pharmacists that I mentioned, that you have grocers, that you have cattle ranchers, that you have labor unions that are all saying, look, we have a problem, I think is probably what has led the leader of our country at the moment to be like, well, it must be true, right? You have a lot of different types of people who are pointing to the same issue. It's that corporations have too much power. Every market is dominated, and there's no room for anyone else to play, from worker to consumer to small or even medium-sized business.
Do we have anything to learn from the experience of the European Union countries? To what extent and in what particular areas have they taken this problem more seriously?
I think we can look to them for some guidance. In the big tech area, we actually are proposing some things that would be more aggressive than what they have done. And also, I think we need to have the learning, and this is something economic liberties that we advocate for in particular, to really address the business model of the big tech companies. So that was a good thing to see in the executive order too, that the president's laying out the need to prevent further mergers, to also prevent the anti-competitive conduct and preferencing on online marketplaces. These are the kinds of moves that are necessary to really attack big tech power in particular at its core, and then have the possibility for other forms of regulation to have an impact.
The FTC brought, in alliance with some state attorney generals, a case against Facebook that was recently thrown out, at least for the time being, by a federal judge. What should we take away from that story?
The FTC case getting thrown out was interesting. You know, and some of the initial coverage of it was like, oh, you know, a win for Facebook, you know, the dismissal, whatever. But once you started digging into it a little bit more, you know, not quite the takeaway that I think people should have. I mean, first, the judge was laying out how the complaint could be amended to then be resubmitted and move forward. And, you know, the FTC has the option of doing that within 30 days from that decision. And so we have every expectation that, based on current leadership, that will happen. It should happen, and it should be fairly straightforward to do that. But the other big takeaway is that we can't rely on the judiciary to solve this problem of big tech power. Some people, even those who will concede that big tech has too much power, want to assert that Article 3 judges can just work it out, that if we give them clear rules of the road, they'll be able to figure it out. And in fact, no, that's the exact problem that we have found ourselves in over a generation. We need bright line rules out of Congress. We need legislation so that we don't have as much discretion with judges that are more trained to defer to the status quo and precedent. Another key development that's happened in this area over the past month or so is seeing bills proposed in Congress. They, you know, haven't fully advanced, of course, but the fact that they're out of committee, that's a good sign. With all of these market areas, really, including big tech, the best solution in many ways is to have legislation out of Congress. But this is a good start to set priorities and also bring focus to the issue so that lots of different parts of the federal bureaucracy can start to get to work as well.
What's an example, or more than one example, of a bright line that Congress could set that would have some impact?
For example, no more mergers, merger moratorium, right? That you just cannot, if you're, you know, of X size, then you just can't acquire another company as easily. And, you know, that's something that has been discussed, especially during the pandemic. And well, since the pandemic started, really, we've been in a merger boom. And, you know, it hasn't really gotten a lot of scrutiny, but the fact that companies are on a buying spree of just gobbling up their competition, we don't even know fully what the impacts of that will be. But that would be the example of a clear line from Congress that would just say, you know, whether it's like applying to a specific industry or more economy-wide, no more mergers for now. And then that's not like, well, we're weighing, you know, facts and circumstances or different tests or whatever that a judge would have to go through. It's just like, no, you can't do this. And And if you do it, you're breaking the law.
How about a common carrier principle for these platform companies? How about telling Amazon and Google and Apple, you can be one thing or the other thing, but if you want to run a marketplace and rent out stalls, you can't also be selling stuff in competition with your own vendors. Amazon, it seems to me, has built a second platform on top of the first platform with its cloud data arm, Amazon Web Services. The conflicts of interest abound.
Exactly. Yeah. And with a lot of the tech platforms, they are, this is critical infrastructure. This is necessary to conduct commerce and communication right now in our country. And if you're in control of such critical infrastructure, we have a way historically of dealing with that. And that is something that should be considered in how we decide to regulate these companies. So I think that that's pretty important too.
Some of these products self-destruct if you attempt to repair them on your own.
Right. I'm not saying I would individually repair anything. I'm not very handy in that way, but I have faith that other people could.
Talk about healthcare, about hospitals, primary care providers, pharmaceutical companies. I believe there's been consolidation in all those areas. Maybe you have some thoughts about private equity's influence over consolidation in the healthcare industry. And I'm wondering whether with that area of consolidation too, you see it in your own community.
For sure. There's been a major degree of consolidation among hospitals. And there also is a role, private equity companies that are gobbling up physician practices and all of it. And then a lot of physicians having to be affiliated with a hospital in order to really survive. And so, we see that in Columbus for sure. It's interesting because for some people, this doesn't seem like it rises to the level of a monopoly because these often are more regional monopolies, but they're having the same kind of impact. The dynamics of, you know, having a lot of control over labor, forcing non-competes. Actually, we hosted an event a few months ago at Economic Liberties focused on concentration in the healthcare sector. And one of our speakers was referencing, you know, this dynamic, I think in one of the prep sessions, actually, how in a rural market in Western PA, not exactly rural, but you might have now only one hospital system. And if you're a doctor, so again, you know, I think a lot of people think like, oh, well, the exploitation of workers is only happening if you're a lower wage worker, which is still very bad, of course, but not understanding that really, we're all kind of exposed to potential exploitation where you have doctors who obviously highly trained and you would think, you know, earning good wages could really compete on the market, that if they're affiliated with one of these hospital systems that have consolidated, there's only one in the area or maybe two, but you have to sign a non-compete in order to get a job with one of them and you want to leave. Well, you can't go to the other one for a year. So what are you going to do? Move from an entire region in order to be able to get another job, uproot your family, or are you going to stick it out and just deal with it? So these are the types of impacts on workers, but, you know, also seeing hospitals that this actually impacted the pandemic too. Hospitals that are hoarding a lot of the PPE and they're willing to get masks from just anywhere perhaps, and they're not going to think about prioritizing American-made masks, for example. And so, you know, it has a lot of different ramifications, but at its core, what's happening is this consolidation, particularly in healthcare space among hospitals, or both hospitals and pharmaceutical companies, is a key reason why prices are increasing. And that's not only prices increasing, but also care decreasing. And then the experience of workers in these systems is also declining.
Some people argue that corporate consolidation is a significant driver of the wage stagnation that has occurred, especially in the lower rungs of the income ladder in this country over recent decades. What is the evidence of that?
Well, we are seeing that wages have not kept up. So the way that, you know, the wages have gone down relative to how much money corporations are earning and also the prices of things. So that was something I referenced earlier, that purchasing price has gone down or purchasing power, I should say, has gone down for workers as a result of this growing concentration crisis. So the research is out there to confirm that. We also have put out our own research and just detailing some of these, we call it ledger of harms from concentration, but we estimate that, yeah, it's cost probably the average worker family about $5,000 a year. And that's not nothing, right? I mean, that's real money. That's money that you could be potentially saving, that you're not going into debt. We know the data from the Federal Reserve, $400 shortfalls are sometimes the difference between a family being okay for a month or getting evicted and going into a financial spiral. And so that's real money, that's real impact. And what's happening is a hoarding of profits, because we are seeing that profits are going up for companies, and they've continued to for a lot of these large corporations throughout the pandemic. So the money is growing. It's just the slice that the average worker is getting is going down.
What steps are you looking to see in the next year or two to give practical force to this order? How do we keep tabs on the follow through?
I would say it's actually going to be very clear how we measure success out of the executive order, because it includes directives for what different agencies either should or are encouraged to do. So we can very closely go agency by agency. Where's the rulemaking? You know, you were supposed to do a study. Where's the study, right? That we're supposed to be seeing within 45 days a plan on how to address some of the pharmaceutical prices, I believe is one of them. And so, you know, getting the outcomes or the outputs from this should be very clear. And when it's not happening, that should also be very clear. And I think that's a really good organizing point for those of us who are in the advocacy space, for elected officials who are monitoring what's coming out of the executive order. There will be a very clear roadmap to say, hey, where is this, you know, different, all the different secretaries, the chair of the FTC, we want to see progress on this. And we do need to keep up the pressure, because it is not a guarantee. The executive order is a historic change in thought on what economic policy and how the economy should be structured, for sure. But we need to keep up the pressure to make sure that the views in it and the ideas of what should get done are actually implemented. So that is going to be a full court press. And then we also need to see some of these positions filled. That's another role that Congress will have to play in confirming some of the leaders of these agencies that are not yet set. We're going to need to have another commissioner at the FTC, and that person will have to be confirmed. And so there's some key personnel pieces to this puzzle that will have to get into place as well. And you know, of course, Congress has a role there. And then overall, I think that Congress can continue to bring these issues to light. And you know, taking another example, the hearing aid example, there was a bill actually in Congress that I believe Elizabeth Warren introduced that got at the hearing aid cartel, so to speak, that, you know, we haven't had different entrants into the market to lower the prices. We're paying a lot more than other countries for what is at this point like a pretty straightforward device. That's because we only have a few companies that do it, and also the professionals who are prescribed them. The fact that we don't have over-the-counter hearing aids available, that's what's kept the prices up. And so, you know, that came out of a bill from Congress. A lot of these other issues, there could be hearings and investigations that relate to the issues to continue to build political pressure and support to do something about them. So that's going to be another important factor in this as well.
Morgan Harper, thank you so much for appearing on Feet to the Fire.
Thanks for having me. It was great.
That's it for now. Feet to the Fire will be back soon with more advice and encouragement for America's new leaders of government and for those working one way or another to get the best out of them. If you like what you hear and identify with our mission, tell some people, and please subscribe on the podcast platform of your choice or online at feet2fire.net.
This land.
was made for you and me.